there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. I want to thank everyone who came over from Angela Anderson's channel for the Castle live stream over there. I'm here with Sarah today.
Hello.
And oh, I just spotted Cinnamon in the house. Yes. So that's exciting. Lots of friends. I'm seeing lots of friendly faces. And that is so nice to see. Sarah will be watching the chat while I'm painting. So if you have any questions as we're going along, just type the word question in all caps. And I've been meaning to make a frequently asked questions page on my website. I haven't got to it yet. But a lot of the moderators know my typical answers to the most frequently asked questions, so they might help you out. If it's something they're stumped with, then Sarah will ask me, and we will get you put to rights on that. This video is sponsored by jerrysartorama.com. If you want any of the supplies I'm using, they're listed in the video description, so you can check it out. I also have a pattern of this. You can print it out and transfer it to your paper if you want to, or you can just freehand it, whatever you like. And there's also a photo of the reference photo on my website, so you can find all that information. Here are the colors we're going to use today. We're going to use quinacridone red, and this is the PR209 as opposed to the PV19. Sometimes your quin red will use a PV19. So you can see it's got a little bit more of a coral undertone to it. It's a very neutral color, so if your red isn't quite that, if it feels more purpley, maybe pick a red that's not quite so purpley. I've got cobalt blue, which is just a little more delicate than ultramarine blue, but if you don't have cobalt, you can use ultramarine. Cad yellow light. You could also use lemon yellow if you don't have cad yellow light. We've got burnt sienna, which is the PBR7 burnt sienna. Sap green, which is a mixture of PG7 and PO62. And yellow ochre, which is PY43, but PY42 is just fine. It's just a synthetic yellow ochre. So, and this, you can see, you get a nice variety of colors just from the three primaries, and the others will just to kind of help us get depth and kind of variety. So we're gonna begin. And I think that takes care of pretty much all the announcements. Oh, the chat might look a little different. YouTube enabled something called Super Chat recently, and people can, and I didn't mention this last week, and awesome Donna Luters had, I hope I pronounced her last name right, she had actually purchased Super Chat last week, and we didn't know what it was, so it got blocked because somebody thought maybe somebody was hacking. Nobody, we're all so new at this. We're all volunteers. So I did want to acknowledge her and thank her for that, and just let you know that's just like a way to, if you wanted to, I don't know, just leave a tip or something. Please don't feel like you have to, but I wanted to let you know what it was in case you were wondering. But what we're going to do is wet the sky area here, and you can use whatever large brush you like. I'm using a number 30 Mimic, and this is a synthetic squirrel brush. I really like these brushes. They're so much less expensive than real fur brushes, and of course they are they're more sustainable. They're less cruel. And they last a long time, so probably last longer than an actual fur brush because you don't have to worry about moths and storage or anything like that. Okay, and after this live stream, the party continues at Cinnamon Cooney, the Art Sherpa's channel. And there are links in the video description. So if you missed Angela's tutorial, you can check that out. And you can find your way to Cinnamon's that way too. I'm gonna grab some cobalt blue. And I'm using my larger palette because I'm working on a larger piece of paper and I knew I was gonna need big washes. So what I do is just grab the color out of my big wells where I've let it dry. And I make a puddle on my palette. And the reason I do that is just so I don't get any chunks of undissolved pigment. It just, and it helps you kind of control your paint flow a little bit. So I recommend doing that. If you're an acrylic painter and you've never done watercolors before and you don't know if you want to invest, go ahead and thin down your acrylic paints for this. If you're working on paper, the paint is going to bond just fine. You don't have to worry about underbinding. That way you can kind of get a feel for it without investing to see if you like it or not. And we're not going to really be doing any lifting on this, so there's no reason in the world you can't use acrylics and have it turn out just wonderfully. I'm kind of painting around cloud areas because I want to try to have this without any lifting so that if you are using acrylics, you're not going to get into any issues. Cobalt's really nice for a sky. It granulates beautifully just like ultramarine, but it's got a more delicate look to it. It's a little less red. I want to do some mountains in the background, so I'm going to add a little of the quin red to my to my blue, and I'll just show you here. I don't know if this is helpful. Do you think it's helpful for me to bring my palette over?
People just... do like to see your palettes. I know that they do ask and comment. They like to see how you set them up and what they look like.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I like to go in like a kind of like a spectrum or rainbow order.
Video's froze for a second.
Oh, there we go. It's so funny. Sometimes it'll freeze during the live, and then when you go and look back at the replay, it's fine. So I'm actually going to, when I'm painting these background mountains, I have the furthest one back is a little bit more purple in it, and I'm leaving some white because I figured if this is springtime, some of those higher elevations will still have some snow. So I kind of want to have some white on it, like maybe there's some snow far away. It's the beginning of spring. It's actually snowing right now here in Maine.
I follow Gagan's Pub on Facebook, and they put up something today. So Mother Nature and winter need to have a few beers together and make spring happen. I am down with that.
Yeah, this winter's been long. I thought it would feel super short having a chance to get away this winter, but man, it still feels long. A little more Quinn.
Well, because we had that nice week there in February where it was like 45, 50, 55 degrees, and it was great, and then it went away.
Yep. Tease.
And it has not been back.
Springtime tease. So I'm working on dry paper here for these mountains, in case I didn't mention it. The only thing we wet was the sky so far.
Berry 39. I just finished a watercolor landscape with background, mid, and foreground, but it was all shades of green, and I had a hard time differentiating distances. Any tips?
Yes, things further away from you should be a little cooler in color, so your green should have more blue in them further away, and as they come forward, they should have more yellow, so that they come the warmer colors with more warm tones like yellow. That's going to give you a sense of it being closer to you. I'm taking some sap green. Isn't that a pretty color? There's different sap greens. Some will be made with a green and a yellow, and some are made with a green and an orange pigment. And this is M. Graham sap green, and it's made with a green and an orange. And that just gives you such a beautiful warmth. And if you don't have this color, take your PG7. It's your phthalo green. Add a little bit of like a nice orangey yellow to it, and that will give you a very similar color. So it's just such a really nice, fresh color. I'm going to add some cobalt to that, though, because I want this green I'm using to be a little bit further in the distance. So I'm applying that tip I just shared with you. So since I'm adding some green to it, it's going to appear to be further back. And I'm actually going to be tapping. Let me start with these back here. I'm tapping some of the tops there, just so it gives me like a little bit of a fuzzy tree line. Can actually maybe add a little bit more blue to that.
Chris Krumenaker, are pigment numbers used universally across all paint manufacturers? For example, does cobalt blue always have the same number in any brand?
Well, the pigment numbers are universal. So somebody might call something cobalt blue and somebody else might call it brilliant sky. But if you know that PB28 is cobalt blue, it doesn't matter what they call it. You know what the pigment is. I was just kind of lifting out some of that color just because I wanted it a little bit lighter in value. Yeah, so the colors, they can name paints whatever they feel like naming them, but the pigment numbers will be consistent. So if you know the pigment number, and if you're confused on the pigment numbers, I have them all listed on my blog today. If you just go over there, that way you can match with what you have. But you can also match it by sight and just make sure you're getting a color with the same kind of bias to it. Now I'm going to take that same color I mixed, except add a little more green to it, so it's a little warmer. It'll have less blue in the mix. And that's what I'm going to do this next. And I actually think I'll add a little yellow ochre to it to kind of desaturate it a little bit and warm it up. I'm going to add that in these hills here. And I'm still working with that number 30 round. It's a great brush. I'm going to go right over. I've got some trees sketched in, but I'm going to go right over them. I want the bottom to be a little flat there. Things are making funny noises in my office.
Not me. I left my phone at
no,
home.
No, it's me.
So I'm innocent this time.
I think it's a face, some sort of Facebook message thing. And now I'm just going to lift a little highlight out just by wiping my brush off. And going across like that. You do a little bit over there, too. There we go. Maybe I'll add a little yellow ochre on top of that, too, just to further brighten it up a little bit and bring it forward. So there we, and the reason I put these mountains in there is because I wanted to have this V-shaped composition that's going to just bring your eye through the picture. So don't be locked into what your reference photo shows you if you're working from a reference photo. Also, you know, use your own sense of style and your own sense of composition to make it just the way you want it. You don't have to be limited by what the reference photo tells you is there.
Cheryl Sussman would like to know what you have your paper taped to.
It's just a piece of hardboard. You can find it at any home improvement store. This one happened to be a free paneling sample. So if I flipped it over, I can actually. Sometimes hardware stores and home improvement centers will have these like, just like they're
scrap. Basically,
well, literally, they're samples. Like that's what they would use to like, so you could pick out paneling that you want to buy, and when they get discontinued, they just have those left over, and they usually just toss them. But they usually are welcome to give them to you. They're willing to give them to you if you want. And now I'm going to do the grass here and here. I think I want to soften that line right there, though, just where it comes into a tree trunk. Just to make sure I don't have a line behind my trees, because that happens sometimes. And I'm going to do that with, actually first I think I'll wet the area. I'm not going to wet right up to the, whoops. And this is why, see where I just painted over there to soften the end of the tree trunk? I just lifted up some of my paint. That's not what I wanted to do. So let me just smooth over this entire area, because I can't really just fix that one spot or it's going to leave a cauliflower. So I'm just kicking up all the paint all the way across. So if that happens to you and you end up with, you've lifted your paint, repaint the entire area, because it's going to be fairly impossible to get that even again after that. So I'm wetting this down here, but leaving a gap between this and the little area I just painted above. I'm kind of doing more of an acrylic painting technique for this painting, because I know that we have some new people here from Cinnamon's tutorials and Angela's tutorials, and I want to do a technique that's going to make a little more sense if you're not familiar with watercolor. And now I'm going to take Sap Green on its own, and I'm just going to go in here and add it. And just kind of let it float on the wet paper. Your paint is only going to flow where your paper's wet.
Sandra James, where is the vanishing point in this picture?
Oh, let's see. The vanishing point for that, like that stream, would be along the horizon line, but probably quite a ways out there. But the vanishing point from the building would be on the horizon line quite a ways that way.
Donna Luders, I purchased the brushes you use and the Turner paints, but my colors don't seem to spread like yours. I wet my paper. What will help? I don't have expensive paper. Could this be why?
That could be. Usually your paint flow is dependent on your paper because of the sizing in it. So if you think of like having just a kitchen towel, like if you think of like a brand new paper towel and you set that down and you set your wet brush on it, it's just going to absorb all that paper. It's not going to paint. The paint's not really going to move around and slide on the top. It's going to suck it right in. But if you had a piece of like brand new heavily sized cardstock and you drop some paper on there, some water on there, it might bead up because there's more sizing in that. And a good watercolor paper will have even more sizing than that because it's designed to work with watercolor. So that's usually what the culprit is, not enough sizing. You can find inexpensive paper that has a good amount of sizing. I'm here adding a little bit of cad yellow light into my sap green just for a lighter color. So I would try, and you don't have to get expensive paper. Canson Montville has quite a bit of sizing in it, and that's not a very expensive paper. The Canson XL Mixed Media Pad also has a lot of sizing in it. as far as a cotton paper like this arches, your paint will flow really well on there because it has internal and external sizing. So that's usually what it is. So I'm leaving that little gap there. I can wash over that in a bit, but I don't want to do it yet because it's going to cauliflower my background if I do that right now. And then this area here, I can just, it's not a very big area. I can just go right in with the paint. And again, I want this to be a little bit lighter. Now I know I'm going to want some kind of flowers along my path here. Again, that's something that I did differently than the reference photo. So what I'm going to do is actually drop in some water because that will kind of push away some of my color here, my pigment, and then I can drop in some of that pretty red. So this is where we kind of almost want a little bit of a cauliflowering effect. So it'll give us almost like a little hedge. Sure. So Sarah's just running outside, so I won't be able to see your questions if you post them. So you might need to repeat them or rely on our awesome moderators and other friends to help. So I'm just blotting out a little bit there. And now I'm going to switch to a smaller brush because that one's just going to hold too much water and paint for me now. This is a number 12 round. You could go anywhere, size 8 and up for this. I'm going to just grab some of the quinacridone red and just kind of just dab it in there. If I dab it directly on the green, it will make more of a brown, because green and red make brown. But if I'm dabbing it in the areas where I just dropped water or I blotted out some of the pigment, it's going to retain its freshness. Don't worry if some of it gets dull though, because that will just look like flowers that have been in the shade. I'm thinking of maybe like a row of tulips have been planted by the stream. There we go.
No?
Okay, now I'm thinking I might do some daffodils over here, but I'm not sure exactly where I want them to be yet. I'm going to go ahead and grab some of that color from the sky, which was just cobalt blue on its own, and water. And I'm just going to throw some of that into the stream. I don't care if some of that green leaks in there because it's going to give me like a natural reflection. And I'm not going to try to get the castle reflected in the water, even though it is in the stream, because I extended the stream and I think the reflections would be a little bit different from this vantage point. And look, it even whipped in some of the red, so it's just giving us a very, very natural a natural reflection. Oh my, wait. Dog is...
we saw a doggy friend walking by, so we got to roll in the snow and bark.
Oh, that's boy. That is exciting.
Gail A., I'm absolutely new to watercolor, and all I have are watercolor pencils. How hard is it to do something like this painting using the pencils? Is it possible at all?
It is possible. What I recommend is working smaller. Work like maybe the size of a greeting card, like a 5x7, and then use smaller brushes, but I got a watercolor pencil right here. Just use your brush, lift off the pigment from the tip, and then go ahead and paint. Just try to pick a very similar to the colors that I'm using here, and you won't have any problem, but I would stick to a small picture because this is going to be a lot of area to cover with a pencil. That's why I'm using my big palette and not like my little pans of watercolor, because it would just be really difficult to get that much color down.
JLT110110. Lindsay, do you have any tips for changing from plastic palette with my watercolors dried in the wells, changing to metal tins and half pans, Winsor Newton?
That's so funny because I had some paints and I've been totally de-stashing, but I love these paints, but they had dried in their tubes. So I cut them out and I put them in big ice cube trays. And then I regretted that because it took up so much space. And I tried to dig them out so I could like maybe put them into a more traditional palette, and I just couldn't remove them. So I think your best bet is to use them up and then go ahead and fill up your metal pan after that. I want to put some daffodils in here. I just wanted to make a little space, and I'm just going to reserve the area here. I'm not really going to do anything too distinct. I just want to get some kind of daffodil blobs, and we can add some more detail. These will be bigger than the flowers that we have over there because they're closer to us, and also they're nice and yellow, so they're going to be a little bit bigger that way too. And plus yellow just gives us a nice pop of color here. And if you're doing them down the path here, they'd get a little bit smaller as they got, as they went away. These are all, what we're doing here is all under, like an underpainting wash type thing. We're going to be refining as we go. And we were talking about Angela's stream, she was calling it the ugly stage. I call it the hot mess stage because that's when everything's just looking bad and we don't know if we're going to be able to fix it, but we can always fix it. So what I'm going to do here is mix up some colors for the castle. And hopefully that's not glaring too bad. I'm going to use some yellow ochre, which is a great color. It's a beautiful neutral, and it just kind of helps mellow stuff out. We're going to grab some cobalt blue. And grab some of that quin red. And we're going to also get some burnt sienna out, because that's a really handy color to have. And then we'll be using these colors to create the colors for our castle. The color we're going to use the most of is a yellow ochre. So I'm going to start, let's see how dry we are. If you touch your painting, like the back or the side of your hand, and it feels room temperature, then it's dry. If it feels cool, it's not dry yet. But around my castle, it's pretty much all room temperature. So I'm going to go ahead and start painting. I'm gonna wet everything first. And I just noticed I forgot a little bit of mountain there, so I'm gonna have to go in and do that later. I'm gonna wet everything that is the brick area, not the roof.
I would just like to say we have over 400 people watching right now.
Wow.
407.
Awesome. So
thank you to everybody who's participating. Say this is awesome.
Please leave a thumbs up before you forget.
Yes.
That would be great. Wow, that's awesome.
I know, it's exciting.
Mm. Yeah, and I want to thank Cinnamon and Angela for inviting me. I know they do these, they do like a monthly collab together. Mm. And it's very nice that they invited me in. I'm a cool kid.
You are a cool kid. You're sitting at the cool lunch table.
I totally am. Pass the tater tots.
Joe Maisky, when doing mountains like these, I lose my white too easily. Does this come down to brush control?
I think it comes down to your paper being dry. If your paper was wet at all, it's going to go everywhere. And it's a little easier to keep your paper, if you're using like a rough paper, it's going to be easier because your paintbrush almost wants to skip a little bit. And you just want to make sure you don't have too much water in your brush as well. I think it's more water is going to be the culprit of too much, of not reserving your whites. You can always go over it with like a product called Watercolor Ground and get your paper back that way. Or you could, you could use a gouache or something if you really wanted that back. The Watercolor Ground does, it looks like you've reserved your whites, which I like that. That's been like my favorite undo tool whenever I do any illustration work and something needs to be changed because I can absolutely get it back to like a starting over without ruining the rest of the picture.
Neil's Farm, how do you know how much sizing is in paper? Is there a code number, something like that?
Not really. It's just kind of by experience or word of mouth. Like, you know, you can ask an art supply store what paper is the most sizing. Arches has a lot of sizing. Milford, I guess. Rich Bowden sent me a sample of Milford. That has a lot of sizing in it. But I haven't used it yet. Different papers have different amounts of sizing, and you may prefer a heavier sized or lighter sized. It just depends on how you paint. Aqua B, I've had some Aqua B paper that's got a heavier size and some that has a lighter, so I think it can vary from batch to batch. I'm going to mix up a little bit of the red and blue. It's going to give me a little bit of a purple. And I'm going to try adding some of that into my shadow areas here. When it dries, it's not going to be quite so bright, so don't worry about having a crazy colored castle. And if you do like the crazy colors, then you could amplify that a little bit. Use less yellow ochre. The yellow ochre will tend to muddy things down.
Cheryl Sussman, what is the difference between gouache and watercolors?
Gouache is opaque. That's the only difference. And you can apply it thicker.
Gracie Shack, if I can't afford arches, what's the next best paper?
Hmm. Let me think. I don't know what's going to be more affordable where you are. I'm doing a little bit of a burnt sienna and ultramarine here to get more of a gray with a smidgen of the red. Strathmore 400 series is pretty good, and that's quite inexpensive. It's the Strathmore with the brown wrapper, not the one with the yellow wrapper. The one with the yellow wrapper, it does seem to have a fair amount of sizing, but it doesn't hold up to repeated washes as well. And it's got like almost an odd uniform texture to the paper that looks like a tire, like you run a tractor over it. You know, it just has that like tire track texture to it, as opposed to the 400 series, which looks a little bit more like a mold-made paper. It just looks higher quality. I'm just kind of finessing some of these blobs of purple to kind of mix in gray down and look a little nicer. The ultramarine blue and burnt sienna will give me more of a neutral gray, and I'm adding that to certain areas as well. That's my probably darkest value. Your cotton papers, 100% cotton papers, are going to, your paint will move on them, but they're a little easier to work with because they don't dry so quickly, so you have more time to blend. It's kind of like if you're an acrylic painter using acrylics with a blending medium or slow drying medium. That's kind of what you get when you're working with a cotton paper with a good amount of sizing. It's a little more forgiving. I'm grabbing some of the red on its own. Very watered. I kind of water it down, then blot my brush off so I don't have too much water, but just so I have a little bit of pigment, and I'm warming up some areas of the castle here, kind of like where the highlights would be.
Patricia Henk, if paper has more sizing, does that give you a little more working time? I have trouble with mine drying out too soon, and that makes it harder to lift colors.
Yes, it does give you a little more working time. Sizing also keeps the paint on top of your paper so you can lift. Now I'm crunching a paper towel and dabbing for a little texture. And this is great if your color was a little too bold and you wanted it. Okay, now I want to do something back here. I think I can, because I have a tree right there, I think I can sneak in the mountains. I think what I want to do is have a little bit of the green mountain area. So I'm just going to pick up that green blue. And I'm just kind of thinking, where would that be tapering down to? Maybe something like that. And I'm going to put a little of the sap green. It's a little bit brighter below that.
Paul Adams says Michaels has a 60% off coupon for today and tomorrow. If anybody I saw the 60%. I was like, coupon 60%. What? My eagle eye spotted a deal.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's an hour away for us.
I know. You could probably use it online if anybody was doing online order.
Oh, that's true. And I will tell you that a lot of times Jerry's Artorama, our fine sponsor, has the same prices or less than what you get with a coupon. So keep that in mind too. You just have to wait. You know, you're gonna wait a week or two.
Sometimes you have to price compare.
Yep.
Just wait.
Yeah, I've been destashing my craft room. I found all kinds of deals that I picked up over the years. Yeah, it's like, my gosh, I don't need to shop again as long as I live.
I've been very good. I've not been buying. I haven't really been in my craft room a whole lot these last couple months, so. Did you get downstairs all finished? Is that all cleaned out?
Almost. It's almost. I'm very excited. I need a little cauliflowering there but that's all right, I think. I'm just filling in the gap and brightening that up with a little bit of sap green mixed with yellow. And maybe there'll be a little row of bushes. So I got those little those little cauliflowers there.
Oh, well. Happy little bushes.
That's right. I'm not going to worry about it.
JLT110110. I've been wanting to try some watercolor ground and have seen some DIY ideas that are a combo of 3 parts gesso to 1 part modeling paste. Might this work, or would gesso resist the watercolor?
Gesso usually resists the watercolor, but watercolor ground is an acrylic. It is an acrylic concoction, so it might work. I don't know. Give it a try. Might as well try before you buy. I just want to do my most like precious painting on it until you know for sure. So for the roof color, I am going to mix some yellow ochre, which I have right there, some of the cad yellow light, and some of this red here. So it's giving me kind of a salmon-y red. And we're just going to go in and paint those dry. Let's just make sure that our... Well, our building's still a little wet. You know, I'm going to... Oh, you know what? I forgot a spot there. That's all right. This is watercolor, so if that dries on our palette, it's not a big deal. I just noticed that I forgot to paint that area, so I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to use my heat tool to dry that so I don't have to worry about cauliflowers.
Jordan Sinclair, which is better, Jane Davenport or Prima watercolors?
They're about the same, to be honest. It depends on what you want to paint, like as far as if you had to pick one set. I think like the Prima Tropicals probably gives you like the most variety and mixability. But if you know all you want to do is portraits, the Jane Davenport neutral set's very good for that. It just depends on what you want to paint. Neither of the sets are terribly light fast. Well, there's no pigment information on the Prima ones. Jane Davenport at least provides pigment information. But, you know, if you want your work to last framed, hung up on the wall, I would probably choose a different kind of paint. But those are, they're fun paints. They're vibrant. You know, they're made more for, like, art journaling. That's, like, work that's going to be closed away in a book. And Jane even says that. She's like, I've got a Daniel Smith set and a Schmincke set if you want something that's a little bit more high-end. But the price reflects that as well. So, you know, get what's what meets your needs. And if you have any more questions while I'm drying this, that would be a great time to ask.
Okay, questions right now.
Awesome.
Well, we got tons of nice positive chat going on, so it's lovely.
Oh, you know, it was so fun to be over on Angela's stream this morning and to be chatting and not like...
I was like, oh, like the pressure is awesome. Off. You can chat. Answering questions.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah. All right, I think that's all that's going to need. I'm just going to give it the back of the hand test. That feels good to me. All right, we're going to go in with that red. I'm still working with the number 12 round. If that feels a little too, if that feels like it's too much paint or holding too much water, you can switch to a smaller brush. Or if you're working on a smaller piece of paper, switch to a smaller brush. I am mixing up a little bit more because I think I'm going to run out. So again, that was the cad yellow light, the quinacridone red, and a little yellow ochre to kind of give it a little body. And I never know what jokes. I never know what you're laughing at. I don't know what the
no,
jokes are.
No, I was laughing at Chewy. She's just randomly looking in the side of a box. I'm like, there's nothing on the box. Ugh.
Yeah, I cooked breakfast this morning, and the kids wanted egg sandwiches.
Egg sandwiches.
The trash was pretty full, and so like I'd scraped out the pan on top. I'm like, oh, that dog's not going to be able to resist that, sitting right on top of the
trash can. She wouldn't have been able to resist. She'd be like, oh.
Nose height.
Oh, yeah, right there.
Crispy eggs. So when you're doing, this is a kind of a controlled wash. When you're doing an area that's fairly small, you don't need to wet the area first, and you want to get a nice, even coverage. So what you want to do is have a handy napkin, blot your brush off, soak up any little puddles after you're done filling in the area. Sometimes you can do a couple, so you only have to wipe your brush once so you don't waste your mix, but you don't want any puddles. Once you have a puddle there, as that dries, your paper dries unevenly, and wherever that puddle has collected, that's where you're going to have your cauliflowers. So to avoid those blooms, just kind of drip, wipe up, sop up any puddles that you have. And try to keep, like, start on one side and work over, so that you're always working against you're not leaving anything to dry too long. You're always working along one wet edge that you're trying to carry across. across.
Michael Ann, I bought the core paints and I want to put them in tins. What is it I see people putting in the pans before squeezing in the paint, and is it necessary?
Well, your core, if you've got the core sets, they come in little tins that are fantastic. And you can actually put a little dollop in the little wells that are in your tin and leave them be. Or you can purchase half pans, and you can squeeze them in the half pans and then clip them into little tins that have half pan holders. Or you can use a magnet on the bottom, which is what I actually have. But I don't have my core. Oh, I do. Hold on. Let me paint this little section and I'll show you.
Which ones are they?
It's a big tin.
The big one on the bottom?
Yes, on the bottom.
The dots?
Yes.
I can reach it. My orangutan arms will make it happen.
Okay, so I'll show you this really quick. So this is how they used to come. I think the set of 12 might come like that now. But we're open here. So I originally squeezed out the color, just little drops in the tins. The stuff goes so far that I still have some of those colors in there, but I didn't wash it because I've got good color there. But then I purchased some little half pans. And I put them in right like that. The half pans are kind of tricky to find in the States, so I had to order mine overseas from Jackson's Art, but they were very reasonable. They'd be like 21 cents for a small one and 30-something cents for a larger one. But you could buy like a bigger palette, like what I'm working with now. It just depends on what your needs are and how portable you need to be and how much space you have to work in. If you love using huge brushes, I would not recommend the half pans. I'd recommend a big palette like this.
Gail A., what pen or pencil does Lindsay use to sketch?
I use a mechanical Pentel pencil with 0.7 millimeter leads.
Because 0.7 is the best.
I love that size, yeah.
I do them when I do my crossword puzzles. I like to use 0.7.
Yeah.
Cheryl Sessman, do you have a video on watercolors for beginners to start with?
I have a playlist for beginner tutorials that are a good place to start. I think it's just called Watercolor Beginners Start Here or something like that. If you just go to my YouTube channel and look under videos, I think it's a playlist tab, you can find it. And that's what I would start with because that has all the basics ones in there. I'm going to take some burnt sienna and some cobalt blue. Mix those together. See how they make a nice, they're kind of like ultramarine blue and burnt sienna. It just kind of makes a gray. It's just more of a delicate gray. And I'm going to add some of the Quin Red into that, a little bit more burnt sienna, because I need a different color for the turrets, the rounded roof on a couple of the spots. It's where you lock away your damsel up here. It is.
Not damsels from Maine. We will have our tools in our back pocket and figure a way to get out.
Yeah. We got our multi-tool.
Then we'll steal the four-wheeler and ride away.
Yeah.
Kevin Crespo, what's a good brand of watercolor crayons that aren't so expensive?
Caran d'Ache is my favorite, but they also tend to be one of the more expensive. But Lyra is also very good and much more affordable. And shop around because you can find some pretty big price differences. Jerry's usually has the best price. But Dosh, and they're almost as good. Just gonna be careful around those roofs, but they appear to be quite dry. Just trying to paint this one in quickly so I can go over and sop up the extra. All right, so I'm drying my brush. I don't need to clean it. I just need to dry it so I make it absorbent, because the paint is going to go where it's driest. Okay, so if I have a big puddle and my brush is dry, it's going to swipe right up into my brush. If I've got a really juicy wet brush and the paper's damp, so the brush is wetter, it's going to leave the brush and go onto the on the less wet paper. It wants to normalize. It's just like tipping water in a pan. It wants to normalize itself. Okay, so now I think I'm going to leave that alone for a bit, and I'm going to come down here and see if what I can do about these daffodils. Now, I do not have a daffodil reference photo, but I think I can fake it well enough. And I'm going to switch to a smaller brush so I can kind of sketch a little bit, because it's been a while since I painted a daffodil. I'm going to take a little, we shall see. You guys have confidence in me, right?
It'll be beautiful.
So I've got some of the Quin Red and the Cad Yellow just to make kind of like a orangey color. And I'm going to put some, I'm just going to put in some of the part of the daffodils, so the trumpet kind of part of the daffodils. So I'm just going to go and sketch those in a couple places.
Zach Penn, are Caran d'Ache watercolor crayons worth their price? I found a set of 84 for half off, which is $75.
For 84 for 70, that's a great deal.
So buy it?
I would. And probably on, you shouldn't tell anybody where you found it until you've already secured your...
Until they've got the confirmation email sent to you.
Yeah. Oh, I hate that. When I tell somebody you have a great deal, then I realize, oh, I really had to stock up on those. And I go and they're all sold out or the company is up the price on them.
Like, why do I have to be so nice?
Yeah, I've never seen a deal as good as I got on mine, but this was like 15 years ago because I've been eyeballing them and watching and waiting for a great price, and they went down to like $60 for a set of 84, and I just nabbed them. They were a great deal, and I've used them a lot, and they hardly wear. You get a lot of use out of them. Mm-hmm. So now I'm going to go in with my brush. I just cleaned it and just kind of blotted it, and I'm just going to soften those lines that I made. This is going to be very impressionistic.
Tiffany Gray, do you need a palette with a cover for juicier paints? Do I need to keep the Honey and M Graham safe and dark?
No, you don't need to keep them dark. I usually let them dry out before I put the lid back on. I like to have a lid just because I have pets and I want to keep cat hair and dust. And like downstairs where my studio is, my husband has a woodworking shop, so there's always sawdust and stuff. So I recommend a palette, or if you can slide it into a Ziploc bag, something like that, so that it's because they're always going to be a little sticky, and you don't want to have stuff stuck in them. I mean, it wouldn't be the end of the world, but it's definitely not optimal. I'm still trying to get the sand out of my palette that I took on vacation. So now I'm just kind of fudging in some leaves here with the Cad Yellow. And while they're wet, I think I'm actually going to drip in some of the orange right to the ends, just to kind of give them a little definition, make them stand out from the stream a little bit. They'll look a lot more like daffodils once we put stems and leaves and stuff. Right now they're just kind of like UFOs. One of my favorite techniques is to paint something with one color and drip in another color and just let it go and see what it does. Back to the Cad Yellow light on its own. I'm going to paint in some.
Retta N, what is Lindsay doing different than she normally does that makes this painting more like acrylic?
Working back to front and not like starting with an overall wash. Still just dropping in the kind of defining the edges and dropping in a little bit of that orangey mix. All right, I'm going to throw in some stems. I'm just going to use sap green. See how that looks on its own. So daffodils stems kind of come out and then go down kind of like at an angle. So some you're going to see that, others you won't. And then I think I'll switch to a dagger and do some grasses. This is what a dagger looks like. It's got longer bristles on one end. It's like a flat, longer bristles on one end and shorter on the other. And it's a great tool for doing grasses. You have to have pretty juicy paint for it. I'm going to do some of this just sap green on its own, and then I'm going to add some yellow. See, I don't have to reload very often. It just kind of keeps on going. The Energizer Bunny of brushes. And look at all these grasses I'm getting without having to reload.
Cheryl Sussman, what brushes do you suggest for beginner? Would royal brushes work? I have some that are too soft for my acrylics.
Yeah, that's a perfect brush to use for watercolors then. Now I'm taking a little of the Cad Yellow Light and adding it into my Sap Green. Doing some more grasses. And now I'm going to start with adding some from the tape. And those are going to be thicker ones because they're closer to the viewer. If it's closer to the bottom of your paper, it's closer to the viewer. And once you put these flowers in with grasses, they don't look so awkward. So don't worry if they weren't perfect. You're not going to know. Impressionism. So Cinnamon's going to be painting Hogwarts Castle, which is
nice.
Kind of exciting because I love Harry Potter.
I do. Well, I didn't. The movies are okay. I wasn't in love with the movies like a lot of people were, but I love the books.
Yeah.
The books and I'm great. Just throwing out there, I do have a birthday coming up in several months, and I don't actually own the Harry Potter books.
Oh, awesome.
So
okay.
If someone was potentially looking for a birthday idea...
That's a good one.
You know, I wouldn't mind having a set of Harry Potter books, or at least a start to the Harry Potter book collection. Just throwing that out there.
All right. Now I'm just going to throw in a few kind of, almost redoing the grasses around the daffodils. I've taken the sap green, added a little bit of cobalt blue. And this is just going to help break them apart from the lawn area there. And it's kind of like, you know, making a pot of chili. You're adding a little bit of this and a little bit of that until you have it just right. All right. You might do a little, maybe turn those pink ones into tulips. I think that might be kind of pretty. All right, so let's do a little texture on the bricks of our castle. Then we're going to do our trees, and that'll be pretty good. It shouldn't take us too long to complete this. We've covered the paper pretty much, so that's a lot of the work taken out of the way. I think I'm going to share a technique with any old ratty hog brush that you have is a wonderful texture tool. And I'm going to show you how to kind of use it in conjunction with a regular watercolor brush. And we've seen me use this for spattering in the past. It's a wonderful technique. I'm going in with that dark color that I mixed. I think you can even see it here. That was the color I mixed for the roof. It was the burnt sienna, cobalt blue, and a little bit of red. This is also makes a really nice nice shadow because it's got a little bit of a purple undertone to it. So what I'm going to do is just kind of add it in here. It's real dark, but don't let it freak you out. You can always blot it off. It's too dark. I'm just kind of dabbing it in this kind of, I'm kind of giving it the impression of like stone or maybe peeled paint. And then after I've added some in, I can kind of drag some of that around. So it's a lot safer to do it this way than to try to, put it on with a brush where you might get a big blob and not be able to fix it. But just keep in mind you do lose some of the control with that brush. But that's part of the charm, is you get that more natural look. Sarah just went to control my children. It's a half day today.
I just said that they were, we could hear them in here. Ask them to just be quiet. And they apologized.
Oh, good.
Alan Smith, if you wanted to make the castle look stone, how would you do it? I'm assuming like a stone texture, which you're doing right
yep,
now.
Yep, this is what I'm doing right now. Well, there's a little bit of a delay, so that could be why. So I'm going in, adding my shadow areas with this. This is a number four, number three, number four. So I'm going in and adding this, and I like to kind of dab it on rather than paint it, just because it gives me more of that natural. So to kind of tap off, thinking you're tapping in some stone, you can use the whole side of your brush too, and then go in with that hog brush and just dry brush it out. It softens it and gives you a little bit of a more textural look. And also the texture on the paper will help too, if you can kind of use that, especially if you have a rougher paper. Usually less is more. When you go back and you look at this tomorrow, you're going to be like, oh, that looks like stone. Once you've gotten, because you get kind of in the practical mindset and you know how you did it, so it's not so magical, but then you kind of forget the next day and you look at it and it's like, oh, that actually looks like something. The painting fairy comes to visit mm-hmm. at night and fixes your picture. And I think just smudge some bits. Don't smudge everything, because then it will look too uniform. You want it to be a little softer than that. And you can also go in and lift away after. You can be like, oh, well, if that's too bold, you can go in with a stiff brush and a little water, scrub it and blot it, and then you'll get another sort of texture, a lighter color of texture. And that's real pretty too. Okay, for this, I actually think I want to maybe have this kind of wall, stone wall, a little bit lighter as you get over, but I do want to have a little bit of shadow here, and I think I might want to put some plants kind of growing up over them, over the walls. So I'll just do a little bit of that too, to put a shadow in. Oh, my reference photo just fell down. Blot a little bit of that away, and then I can put some plants above that. Oh, I'll show you the reference photo actually, since it fell down. There it is. See what we're going from there. And I'm going to hopefully set that somewhere I can see it good enough, I guess. We're live.
I'm going to say, this is real life, people. Real life. This isn't some fancy, overly produced reality TV show. This is...
Yeah. St. Martha Stewart, people.
Not Martha Stewart. I'm not interested in being Martha. I love Martha Stewart. I just, I have too much reading and other things to do with my time.
Cannot keep up with that perfection.
Yes. Linda DB, if you use a brush for acrylic, can you clean it well enough to use for watercolor?
Oh, yeah. You're not going to hurt an acrylic brush using it with watercolor. You can hurt a watercolor brush using it with acrylic, but there's nothing watercolor can do to hurt your acrylic brush. But if you do get... if you do get, because watercolor brushes will last you forever, I think, as long as you take care of them. So if you do really get into watercolor, I would suggest, especially if you end up getting some softer brushes for them, that you do reserve them just for watercolor. Because acrylic brushes, with acrylics, you need to replace them. The paint, if it gets in the ferrule in this part here and dries, it splits the ends and you don't get a nice crisp chisel edge on them anymore, or chisel or crisp point on them anymore. So I would just, if you do buy some good watercolor brushes, keep them for watercolor. But you can use your acrylic brushes for watercolor as long as you want. You're not going to hurt them a bit. And acrylic paint's not going to transfer into your watercolors. It just dries too, quickly and permanently for that to happen. You'd have to be trying to mix them up if you mix them up.
Jordan Sinclair, are Derwent Academy watercolor pencils good?
I haven't tried the Academy ones. I don't know.
I'm sure somebody in chat has. We have over 400 people watching right now.
Let us know if you've tried them. Yeah, I do like all the Derwent products I've tried, except for the metallic pencils. But they're a water-soluble pencil, and it seems like when you add water, they just kind of go away. But somebody else told me they love them, but they don't add water to them because they just use them dry, and they're really rich and metallic. So I think that might be kind of user error on my part. Maybe just use them dry, even though they're water-soluble. Using the side of the brush to get a little bit of a dry brushing with my paintbrush here. And there really isn't any texture on the roof. I can add a little detail to the turrets here. I'm just going to do a little burnt sienna and cobalt blue to make it nice dark. And I'm just going to add, I'm going to kind of brace my arm with my hand. You can't really see because it's off camera, but I'm using my hand to hold my arm off the paper and keep it steady. And I'm just going to throw in a little bit of detail there, not too much.
Gail A, has Lindsay ever used the new pens for watercolor with the brush tips? They look really great.
Yeah, I've used the, I just got the mermaid markers, which I really like. They're only available at Michael's currently or the Jane Davenport website. And previously I've had the Paintastics by Elmer's and the Ben Fang watercolor brush pens. And they're very similar. I like the tips more on the mermaid markers because they're springier. But yeah, they are a lot of fun. They are more, I think the Ben Fang ones might have a pigment watercolor in them, and the Jane Davenport ones have a dye. But they're really fun to use. I think probably the reason it's not a pigment in them is because the ones that I had from Ben Fang with the pigments, they occasionally clog and make a huge mess. So I think that's probably why. I'm going to use that same color to paint in any windows that I put on here.
Karen Kowalczyk, if you decided to put the castle reflection in, could you do that after the water is already dry?
You could. I think watercolor reflections look best when they're done all at once, because they can get looking real fussy really easily. And you can't really just paint the whole thing over again, unless you want to, you know, put watercolor ground and let it dry and then do that. So, if you re-wet the area, you might give it a try, I guess. I think that, you know, if you're just going to dance in a little bit here and there, you'd be all right. But the reflection is almost a little bit lighter than the sky here. So, yeah, I guess you could. But I think that I would do it first, for one thing. If you mess it up, you haven't spent a lot of time on the painting. And it's not that big of a loss. But I chose to leave it out because I think that it was going to be more likely to be awkward than it was to be enhancing the picture at all.
Zach Penn, I want to rearrange the colors on my palette. Is there a way to do this without wasting paint?
Not really. I'd wait till the paint's gone. I mean, that's one of the benefits of using half pans, because then you could lay them out in your palette however you want, or put them in a tin however you want and move them around if you want to. I'm just adding little bits of that dark color here and there. It's kind of tapping it in. It's not very much on my brush. I'm just putting it in any of the really dark areas. It just gives it a little bit of depth.
There's Amy Knudsen, no, framed a landscape but wants to go back and add detail. Can she do that or will she ruin it?
Is it a watercolor? She wants to take it out of the, you could take it out of the frame and you could do more to it, I suppose. Yeah, I don't see why not. You never know when you add something to it, what the effect is going to be 100%. So, you know, it's just, if you're not happy with it, go ahead. If you're willing to risk changing it, and you know, that's why not. Okay, so now I want to throw those trees in. And I think that I'm going to go back to that dagger brush because that's kind of a fun one, especially for those little trees in the background. I think it rolled under my... Oh, where did it go? Well, maybe I won't because I don't see it right off the bat. Round it is then. I'm going to take some burnt sienna and dull it down with a little bit of cobalt. That's going to gray it down a little bit. And I like to start trees at the base, and I did have this real close to the edge of the water there, but I think I'm going to tuck it back in behind these flowers.
JLT 110110 wants to know if the round Prince and Neptune brushes are similar to the Mimic Squirrel.
Very similar.
Northern Birder, how would you do weathered shingles compared to stone? Don't you have a couple of tutorials?
I do. Check out the Lobster Shack tutorial. That one we do weathered shingles. I have that tucked in right behind there, I think. I'm going to keep my branches kind of spotty because I'm going to put some leaves. At least some buds. I don't want it to be completely bare tree there. And remember, this is going to dry a little bit lighter. So if this looks like, whoa, that's way too dark, it's not dry yet.
Zoe Gilman, if acrylics are all about layers, is there a word to define using watercolors?
Transparency, luminosity, you're working with light. The paper is a color. You know, you got to keep in mind that the paper is your white and your paper is a color. So everything you do, the paper is going to interact and interfere and reflect. So you need to just make sure that you're giving the paper the respect that it needs, because it's doing a very important job in your painting. Make sure this tree goes right off the edge. This last one here, it's going to help with that visual triangle. I'm just gonna tuck it in there right next to the pond or stream. I guess it's a stream. So I like to start with those because they're not really that important compared to these ones that are right, this one going on top of the castle. This one we want to make sure we don't mess up. So now we've got our kind of our bearings. We're just gonna put in these little branches here. Try to work on the tip of that brush. You do that by working your brush at a 90 degree angle. I apologize if that puts my hand right in the way for you, but if you keep this at a 90 degree angle with your paper, that gives you the finest point that you can get from your brush. And you can use a dagger or a liner for this as well, also called a rigger. The good old round works real good. When I go out and paint on location, I have like one brush. It's like a number 10 round, and I can do most things I need to do with that. So you don't have to have a ton of brushes. I mean, it can make your life a little easier. Mostly what a variety of brushes does, it keeps you from making everything look the same. It keeps you from helps you vary your strokes a little bit.
S. Lee, have you ever tried Shinhan watercolors?
I haven't. I have some in my my shopping cart to try, but I'm not sure. There's two sets, and there's a huge price difference. One says artist quality, and one says professional quality. So I just don't know how it's a huge.
I shouldn't laugh. That's kind of professional and artist quality.
So I don't, you know, well, I don't want to spend, you know, three times the price if there's really not that much of a difference, you know, but, and I don't really need more watercolors. So, you know, I don't want a cheap thrill. I want a cheap thrill and I want it to be good.
What? Just the way that you said it, that's all.
I'm looking for cheap thrills over here, people.
I was good. I didn't say a word. I'm zipping my lips shut.
I want to flick this on so it looks like little buds. And then I will dab some on too. You could also sponge on some of these leaves. I want them small and that spring green color so that I have it's just real fresh looking. Well, that's the whole thing about the, because listened to the audiobook, The Magic, Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up. And that's one of the things she says, sometimes a purchase is just gives you a thrill when you buy it, and that's all it's meant to do, you know?
Sometimes you have to just leave it in your cart and walk away.
Yep.
I've noticed over the years, I've gotten better at that. And I don't buy like I used to. Because I'm like, do I need it? Where am I putting it?
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, oh, I don't really. And most of the 9 times out of 10, when I just walk away, I don't even think about what I was looking at before.
Yeah. Yeah, it makes you a smarter shopper. Probably not as fun of a shopper, but smarter one anyway.
Well, no, but, you know, it's nice to be able to just kind of go and be able to look at stuff. Yeah. And not like go home and be like, oh, what did I buy? And so much stuff. I'm like,
yeah.
Although I will say I did just buy one of the best purchases I've bought in quite some time.
Oh, what's that?
Because the cats like to sleep on the bed. Uh-huh. Of course, they get their cat hair all over the comforters. And of course, to wash the comforters, I have to go to the laundromat.
So you bought a washing machine?
So we have, I wish, let's not get into that discussion.
Oh, okay. Touchy subject.
So, I mean, like, we have a pet attachment on the vacuum cleaner, but it's, like, super strong pet attachment. Like, it's great for, like, couches and cars, carpeting, stuff like that. Uh-huh. I was afraid it was going to tear, you know, tear a hole or, you know, pull the fabric. Yeah. So I was looking online at Amazon, and Bissell makes a handheld pet remover, hair removal, vac. Like, it's a handheld plug-in. So it was like $29. Filters, they're pretty inexpensive to replace, easily cleanable, very mobile. It's got like a 16-foot power cord on it. Mm-hmm. Got it today, used it on the blanket, uh-huh, on the bedding. Holy manoli, that thing is awesome.
It was worth great.
Every penny. Awesome. I was like, oh my God, this is, look at all the cat hair coming up. So then when I do go to wash it at the laundromat, I'm still not stuck with like stray hairs all over the place. Oh.
Cheap thrills.
Cheap thrills. $29 is free shipping. I was so excited.
That is exciting. I want a steam mop. I think those would be great.
Can you use those on like the laminate flooring though?
No, I can only use them on my kitchen floor.
Yeah. See, and that's all we have. And that would be worth it. Because
that is a pain in the butt to scrub because it's got that, it's a cushion.
Yeah.
You got the texture. All right. I'm also going to flick in a little bit of, I'm going to let that dry first. And I'll flick in a little bit of kind of like that red, that Quinn red, because it will look like the little buds, you know, they come out and they've got they're tight and they've got like the pink. Maybe like they're a flowering tree or something, like crab apple trees. I'm going to work on these a little bit. I'm going to switch to a smaller brush. This is my number 4 round again. I'm going to go right in with that Quinn red. But of course, tapping it on my palette first, just to make sure I don't have any big blobs. And I think I'm just going to do some simple little tulip flowers. Just put a couple little strokes in kind of like an oval shape, make them slightly bigger and this end of the paper, because and as it tapers away they're going to get a little bit smaller. It's still not that much further back in the field of depth of field, so in our field of vision, so they don't have to get really teeny tiny, but they're going to get just a little bit progressively smaller. Try to have them tipping different ways. You don't want them all lined up like soldiers. Some can be taller, some can be shorter. And because we had reserved that space when we dripped our water in there at the beginning, our reds have no problem competing with that green. In fact, the green next to it is making them appear to be brighter because they're opposites on the color wheel.
Baru Siva, is there any special soap to use with brush for masking fluid? The moment I dipped it in dishwashing liquid and in the masking fluid, it kind of dried and stuck.
That's strange. Not that I know of. I've used all kinds of soap. I've used bar soap. I've used lava soap. I've used dish soap. Dish soap is usually what I use because I'm usually close to the sink. And I just coat it really well. And then I just dip the tip of the brush in the masking fluid. I don't let the masking fluid go beyond like half of the bristles if I can help it. And I use a synthetic, like a cheaper synthetic brush, not my ones I would typically paint with, because if I did make a mistake and didn't wash it quick enough or whatever, I wouldn't want to ruin one of my expensive brushes. And plus, I prefer to have a little bit stiffer of a brush for masking fluid, because just to kind of help guide it around. And some people use like a color shapers, which are like a rubber tipped tool that you just wipe off. You don't need to put soap on. I'm just putting in a few stems. I think I might add a little blue to that, actually, a little cobalt blue in that green. Less detail, just kind of little dots and dabs as you get further away. And now I'm gonna, gosh, have you seen my dagger brush?
No.
That's weird. Where could it have gone?
Let it roll underneath on the side, maybe.
Gosh, that's weird. I don't see
I've done that.
I really like how I get a nice sharp line from that, but I guess I'll just use this one. And I'm going to go in with a little bit more of a yellow green. So I've got the sap green with more yellow in the mix. And I'm just going to go in and flick in some more little grasses. That might be a nice area. If you had a tiny little sponge to sponge in a little bit of moss around the edge, that'd be pretty. I don't know why I don't have a sponge up here. How's everyone doing in chat?
Good. A couple people are asking me about the pet hair vac that I bought. It really is. Like, I'm not normally like, oh, you know, but I would. All the reviews are really great on. As soon as I tried, I was like, this is worth every penny.
Life changing. It's a life changing. Yeah, I love life changing things.
Because John has allergies, you know, so it's like, if I can keep the pet hair down on the bedding, that will definitely help. Because, I mean, I guess conceivably I could go to the laundromat because we have a king size bed. I have to use, like, the super washers.
Right.
Which are, like, you know, $15 a paw.
What?
Like, they're expensive. Seriously? And then in the wintertime, like, in the summer, that's fine because I can hang everything out to dry.
Yeah.
But in the wintertime here, I don't have any... I have a king size giant comforter. There's nowhere to hang it to let it dry. It wouldn't take, you know, 2 days.
Yeah. Ugh. I wonder if it would fit an air washer and dryer.
No, no, it wouldn't. Because I tried using like the bigger washer dryer at the laundromat. And yeah. I have to use like the giant king size.
Oh, that's a bummer.
35 quarters.
I'm going to define the edge of my, stream here. I don't want it too uniform, so I'm just gonna wiggle in my hand back and forth and just touching it down here and there. Got a little brown to that too, I think. I think we got some good depth in this picture going on. It's fun to take a reference photo, use one portion of it, and then make up the rest. You know, you've got that. The, I don't want to say crutch, but you've got a little bit of a foundation, a little bit of a guidepost, and then you can just kind of do your own thing. So I guess that's how you can approach any of the tutorials you find online. Start it off as a guidepost and do your own thing to it. I don't want to pull some of that color into the water. I'm just going to use a wet brush and just kind of drag it over a little bit. So this would be a way that you could do your reflections after the fact. You just, I wouldn't be too hung up on having it exactly matching something like a symmetrical building, but you could get some of that color in there and just drag it out. Maybe pull a little bit of that green here and there too. Alternate applying color and then smearing it out with the brush. Belle thought I was going to do acrylics today because Cinnamon and Angela do acrylics.
Yes. But you're mixing it up today.
I think I'll throw a little bit more blue in there. Give it a little sparkle. And gosh, we're almost done here. Don't worry if you get something too dark. Just wet your brush and go in after that color and spread it out a little bit. Sometimes it's that little bit of dark that gives it a life that you need. All right, is there anything you think this needs? I do want to flick a little bit of that red in the trees, but...
Does it need some happy birds? No, I don't think it needs anything. I think it looks great.
Happy little mice playing in the castle. I've heard reports that Beauty and the Beast movie is good.
Have you? No. My last two forays into live Disney features like that were not, I was just did not enjoy them. I'll probably wait till it comes out and I'll like rent it at Redbox or something.
Yeah. Watch it with Eleanor.
I don't know. What's it rated? It might be too.
Oh, I don't know. I just assumed it was a.
I'm gonna like say it's gotta be PG at least. Although I did buy that movie Sing, the Pixar one with all the animals, and I didn't realize till after I had bought it that it was PG.
Oh, is it really?
But I watched some of it with Eleanor, and anything that would have been PG went right over her head. So.
All right, so I want to do a little bit of flicking of red in the trees. I think I'm going to use this brush here. You could also use a toothbrush. I'm going to take the quinacridone red.
Oh, Amy John says it's PG. The wolves are a bit scary for little kids, so maybe in a year or two.
Yeah. All right. If you get too much splatter, you can always blot it. I think I'm going to do a little bit of that in the green as well. It's a different texture of splatter than what I did with a paintbrush. I'm going to get this tree right here a little bit more of a definition, so I'm tapping a little bit of that in there. Probably could have made my branches a little less pronounced. And then they wouldn't show up so much. I can do a little more yellow in there. Cad yellow does tend to be opaque because of the mineral in it. Cadmium is a more opaque mineral, so you can use that to cover up if you need to. I think I like that. I think I want to do some of that with this brush along the edge. Get a little mossy edge there. All right, I didn't put any texture in that part of this part of the tower, I just noticed. So I'm just going to grab some of that color gray off my palette and just dab a little bit in there. Okay, I think this is done. So if you have any last minute questions, go ahead and ask them. Maybe I'll do a little just defining on the daffodil while I wait for any last minute questions, and we'll remove the tape. And always looks better with the tape removed for some reason.
Mm-mm-mm. I think we're a couple different topics going on right now. So
just define a few of these petals on some of the daffodils here. You should practice. If you can, practice a little bit every day, because then it's going to be a lot easier for you to adapt a reference photo. Do we freeze up?
No, it was error on my part.
Oh.
Alicia M., how do you store your brushes?
I just put them in a jar or a bucket on my desk. I leave them flat on the table until they're dry, like after I'm done painting, and then I just pop them in a jar afterwards.
Cameron Owens, has Lindsay ever done a tutorial on mice or rats or mice/rats or plan to?
You know, I haven't. I have a squirrel tutorial.
Riska, any tips for someone with shaky hands?
Get either buy a bridge. It's like a plastic, it almost looks like a ruler, but it's got legs and you can rest your hand against it while you're painting. Mm. Or you can make something like that out of wood, I'm sure, will work just as well. It's basically so you can hover your hand above so you have a little stability. We're going to remove our tape by pulling it at a 45 degree angle against itself. That reduces the tension on the paper and keeps it from ripping. Do that for all four sides. This is 140 pound watercolor paper, so it does dry pretty flat if you've taped it down. You can always stretch it if you want to, but I always find that works pretty well. And there is our finished picture. My camera's a little crooked there. Well, my camera's gonna fall off if I keep turning it like that. Whoops. There we go. All right, so there we have it. The next tutorial will begin in about 15 minutes, I think, over on Cinnamon's channel, I do believe. And you can check that out. She's going to be painting Hogwarts Castle from the Harry Potter movies, which will be a lot of fun. And I'm sure I'll see you over there for a little while. I'll be over there to watch what she's up to. If you have any questions after the broadcast, go ahead and leave it in the comments. You can do that as soon as I press stop. And I want to thank our sponsor, jerrysartorama.com. They have all the supplies I use today, best prices on the internet usually. And go check them out. They always have coupons on their homepage too, so you can save a little bit more money even from their regular low, low prices. Thank you so much for watching. And don't forget, if you missed Angela Anderson's tutorial, she did a beautiful fairy tale castle in acrylics. There's a link to that in the video description. And we can all head over to Cinnamon's channel and watch her live tutorial as well. Please give it a thumbs up before you go. And I guess that's it. Do you have anything else to add, Sarah?
Nope. Great time today, though.
Yes. Awesome. Thank you all for watching, and happy crafting.